Hi, I'm Dick DeMerchant. Welcome to our Wednesday night Bible study at First Baptist Church in Lenore City, Tennessee. I have with me my son, Lance DeMerchant, and his wife, Tara. And I've asked them to share a couple songs tonight as we get ready for our Bible study from Daniel chapter 3.
Night, head on the open sea.
Amen. Sure enjoyed that. Every time my son is around me and he's here for service, that's the song I always ask him because it's my favorite song. I think it's got a great message in it. My anchor holds. My anchor is Jesus in spite of the storms that come on our lives. I want you to take your Bibles with me tonight and we're going to share a few thoughts from Daniel. Really in chapter 3, but it actually covers the first six chapters of Daniel. Don't worry, I won't preach on all six chapters. I'll be through within a couple hours. The story of Daniel is a story about faith and courage. One of the lessons that we can learn from Daniel is that Daniel had the courage to say no when things were wrong. But Daniel also had the wisdom to say yes when things were right. Great lesson there that Daniel shares with us. The first six chapters of the book of Daniel talks about us, about the setting here is in Babylon, and it tells a story of Daniel and his three friends, as we know, as Babylon names, as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They were the best and the brightest Jews that were taken into captivity from Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, when he captured Jerusalem in 605 BC. Daniel, they feel, was approximately about 20 years of age, and he became a slave on the staff of the royal palace of the king of Babylon. The nation of Judah had sinned, and as a result, God punished them and sent the Babylonians in, and they were captured, and several were saved and taken to Babylon to serve. And so approximately Daniel and 75 other Jewish boys were taken. But out of that, Daniel and three rose to the top, which are Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Daniel was young because the Babylonians needed bright young minds to come to Babylon, and they feel they could indoctrinate them there because these were Jewish boys, and so they were spared what many others failed in that fight and lost their lives. But Daniel, he was transported in captivity, first of all, to a place that was 900 miles away. Just picture picking up and taken in captivity 900 miles. And the people that took him there destroyed his homeland. He was taken from his family. And at the same time, they were taken to a place of evil influence. All that was coming on Daniel's life. Daniel's first test was about when he got there was regarding a diet. Of all tests that was put to, you would think that'd be a simple test, but not really. He accepted a Babylonian name. He accepted the Babylonian education, yet he could not accept the Babylonian diet. So he knew when he had to say no, and he also knew what he could say yes to. He could have said, I'll go along with and get my education, so I'll go along with this diet. Or he could have said, when in Babylon, do as the Babylonians do. Or he could have said,
I'll never see Jerusalem again, so what does it matter? I'll just go along with the crowd. Jesus said in Luke chapter 16, verse 10, whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. Daniel made up his mind that he was not going to defile himself with the rich young food and the alcohol that would come from the king's table. You see, God will never bless and mount his goodness on bad character. Just won't do it. One of the most difficult things in Daniel and his three friends was to be faithful to their religious beliefs in a city that was filled with immorality. Daniel's first test regarding this diet, he was fed from the king's table, so he had to make a decision. And his decision was that he would give him an alternative. He said, give me vegetables and give me water for 10 days to me and my three friends and see if we don't look better. If not, then judge us after that. And of course, they did look better, and so they were allowed to take a stand which was recognized. And then you'll find in Daniel chapter 2 that the king had a dream and Daniel interpreted the dream. And so he was given, along with his three friends, positions in Nebuchadnezzar's government. He was rewarded for doing the right thing. God always blesses and honors when we do the right thing. Daniel and his three friends knew that adultery was unacceptable to God, and so they couldn't bow down to images. And so an idol is, what is an idol? An idol is anything that we put before God in our lives. Hey, to some that could be a car. To some it could be a job. To others it could be a hobby or a house or a family. But lots of people have possessions as a god before their family, before other things, especially how they worship God. And so therefore, it's very easy to see how a lot of us unbeknownly make gods that we don't realize are really gods. And what they are, they're idols that are in our lives that are in front of God. And so all of a sudden now you have a dedication of a golden image. So Nebuchadnezzar, the Bible says, built an image of gold. Now, very expensive. And that image was 90 feet tall and 9 feet wide. It was set on the plains of Dura, and it was very impressive. You could see it from miles away. The king invited all the officials to come to this dedication. Now, those officials was also Daniel's three friends. Now, when you read the scripture, you'll find that Daniel wasn't there because at this time he was actually a prime minister of Babylon. But you'll find that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego was there, and they were dressed for the occasion. And so it was more than a dedication. Why was it more than a dedication? Because they were forced to worship an image. True worship is an expression of the heart. It is never and cannot be forced. It must come from the heart. Nebuchadnezzar had established a horrible penalty, though, for those people who didn't bow down. So we find in Daniel chapter 3 the setting. So Daniel chapter 3, verses 8, starting, it says, therefore, at that certain time, Chaldeans came forward and maliciously accused the Jews. Why were they? Because they were jealous. Isn't this something what jealousy will do to an individual or to people in general? And so they wanted the positions that were given to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So they were watching these three all the time. And so verse 9, they declared to King Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. They didn't really mean it. They just wanted to get his attention. You, O king, have made a decree that every man who hears the sound of the horn, the pipe, the lyre, the trigon, the harp, the bagpipe, and every other kind of music shall fall down and worship the golden image. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast into a burning furnace. Therefore, there are certain Jews who you have appointed to fairs and governors of the provinces, and those people are Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, pay no attention to you. That was a false claim. They do pay attention because they were given positions. But the last two statements are true. They do not serve your gods, and they do not worship the golden image that you have set up. So they have actually, the Chaldeans, made a direct charge against the Hebrews. So now it's on the Hebrews. So there's a declaration of God's power that takes place. First is the dedication of the golden image, and now the Nebuchadnezzar, he's in a rage. So he calls the three Hebrew children in. What's really interesting, he actually gives them a second chance, because it's reported here, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the golden image that I have set down? Verse 15. Now, if you are ready, when you hear the sound of the horn and all the rest of them and the music and fall down and worship the image that I have made, well and good. But if you do not worship, and you shall immediately be cast into the burning fiery furnace. And here's the question. And who is the God who will deliver you out of my hands? He didn't know that God, but Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego knew that God. These three Hebrew boys had carefully weighed the consequences of refusing to obey the king. They knew what the challenge was. They knew what the result would be. They were being true to God, and it took a great deal of courage for them to take the position. See, like Daniel, they knew when to say no, and they knew when to say yes. They made it very clear. It is God's will. He will deliver us out of your hand. That's what they're saying to the king. Regardless of the outcome, these three had purpose to serve God and not worship an idol of adultery, which the Babylonians were accustomed to doing. Then we see the deliverance take place. Then Nebuchadnezzar, he was full of fury. He was so mad, the Bible says, that the expression of his face was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Remember, they were rulers over some of his provinces. And now all of a sudden, because they didn't worship the idol. Now the idol, many people believe, was an image of Nebuchadnezzar. And so it was really unifying a country to worship him. And so therefore, he ordered the furnace to be heated 7 times. It was heated hotter than that furnace had ever been heated before. Verse 20. And he ordered some of the mighty men of his army. When you do some research, that you'll find that those two men were part of the royal guard of the royal family. And so they bid Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the burning fire. The haste and high temperature caused the two guards to fall down and perish in the flames. It was an open furnace, and Nebuchadnezzar expected the men to expire at once. But then we see three men, and they were alive, and they were walking around in the fire. Not only did these three men walk around in the fire, but then the Bible says he saw a fourth man as being the form as the Son of God. Now, King had no spiritual perception to himself, but he could testify what he could see. What must it be like? And I thought about this. What must it be like to be in the fire 7 times hotter, walking around with Jesus? Can you imagine what was going through Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's mind? And he was in full control, who was Jesus, of the situation. And they were not looking. Look at the scriptures. They were not looking for an exit. They were just walking around with Jesus. They were comfortable being in the fire that was 7 times hotter because Jesus was with them. When Jesus is with you, you can be in the fire and find comfort. They were content in the fire with Jesus. So much so, verse 26 says this, Nebuchadnezzar had to bid them to come out. They were comfortable staying in. They had to be asked to come on out. And then what happened to verse 27? They were a witness to all the people at the dedication. Remember when all the officials were invited to come worship the idol? They were still there because verse 27 says this, at the dedication of the image, who was there? The satraps, the prefects, the governors, the king's advisors gathered around. Who? They saw the fire and saw that it had no effect on the bodies of these three men. Not a hair of their heads were touched nor singed. Their robes were unaffected, and there were no smell of fire on them. Not only were they in the fire with Jesus, but when they come out, they were a witness to everybody that showed up at the idol. And so not only did they affect the king, they affected everybody else. So we have a dedication of the golden image. We have these three Hebrew boys that declared the power of God. And then you see how God came and delivered them. And now the very end, you will see in verse 29, therefore, there's a decree. And so, therefore, I make a decree. Any people, nation, or language that speaks anything against God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Just notice the wording there. It never says it was Nebuchadnezzar's God. It was Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's God. When you read on in Daniel, you will see he didn't learn a lot of lessons. And he said, if that happens, if they worship any other God, they'll be torn from limb, their houses will be in ruins, for there's no other God who is able to rescue in this way. Verse 30, then the king pronounced a promotion for Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego in the province of Babylon. Being obedient to God brings blessings from God. Can you imagine the king promoted the people that he just was so disgusted with? What changed his view of the Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? God did. Why? Because they took a stand and he could see it was a right stand. But I want to ask you a question in closing, and here it is. Where do you think that the three Hebrew boys of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego saw faith in action? Remember, who they come out of Judah with? Daniel. They saw faith in Daniel, and Daniel had spent time with them. And so therefore, they saw faith in action and built their faith. I heard a story of a religious man who decided to purchase a statue of Jesus Christ for his home. He brought it home and he set it on the coffee table. His wife, not very long after that, moved it because she didn't like it, the place, and so she moved it to a den. Well, then later he moved it again because he didn't like it in the den. A two-year-old boy then looked at all this and he said this, Mom, Dad, can't you decide what you're going to do with Jesus? I guess that's my question tonight to all of us. In troublesome times, we need to decide, what are we going to do with Jesus? Are we going to say yes to him, which is the right decision? Are we going to have courage to say no when we're supposed to say no, and have the wisdom to say yes when it's the right thing to do? May God bless you for tuning in to us tonight. Let's have a word of prayer together. Father, thank you for the word of God. Thank you, Father, for it's powerful and sharp. And Father, it's like a razor to our soul. And so, Lord, I pray that you would help us to learn as you write it in Scripture and you pierce it into our hearts. May we learn from you tonight. Speak to us in this troublesome time, I pray, that we may see the Lord Jesus Christ and be a part of the family that's walking around with him in the midst of the fire. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.